This series is meant to be a critical look at neoclassical microeconomics from a heterodox perspective, based on a textbook written by Ben Fine. This video focuses on the key methods of neoclassical microeconomics, which Ben Fine sees as a major weakness while seemingly paradoxically allowing for the widespread application of microeconomic methodologies within economics. Fine examines the history of neoclassical microeconomics through a critical lens, engaging with both the theoretical development and the institutional and political factors shaping the current discipline. The core microeconomic concepts he focuses on are what he calls 1. The technical apparatus, using simple functions to model individuals trying to maximize their utility, and 2. The technical architecture, trying to derive economy-wide conclusions about equilibrium and efficiency from these models of individuals. Together, these form the TA squared, a very limited methodology which has become increasingly dominant within economics. The marginal revolution, genesis of the TA squared. The marginalist revolution in economics took place in the 1870s. It focused on how economic decisions could be optimized if costs and benefits were modeled by differentiable functions. Before these marginal revolutionaries, economics had been defined by the classical school, which is a topic for another day. But for now, just note that there is way more to classical economics than just being a primitive version of neoclassical economics. The marginal revolution shifted economics from its previous basis and class and its relation to land, labor, and capital, instead focusing on a more abstract, optimizing individual. It also shifted the focus from the classical, unformalized focus on growth and dynamics to a formalized system for finding stable, static, optimal equilibrium in markets. Finally, this shift created a new subjective theory of value based on consumer preference, which replaced previous theories of value in mainstream economics, which were calculated from the cost of production, such as the labor theory of value. Implosion. Although formalized, these new theories could not incorporate many aspects of individual behavior without the risk of becoming unsolvable, and so depended on a wide collection of assumptions in order to derive market equilibrium. Ironically, these assumptions can mean that we assume away many significant aspects of individuality in a methodology nominally deeply concerned with the concept. The debate over whether unrealistic but useful assumptions should be used for model building is quite complex. What is notable is the degree to which microeconomics incorporates unrealistic assumptions, the unquestioning way this is often done, and its divergence from other social sciences in this regard. Further, although it is often claimed that if they did not make good predictions, these assumptions would be falsified by empirical evidence, in practice, statistical evidence from economics is normally too messy to be conclusive, and there is enough wiggle room within the neoclassical theory to make it fit a wide range of datasets. This mission to exclude anything from neoclassical microeconomics which can't be deduced from aggregates of rational individual behavior is what Ben Fine calls the implosion of microeconomics. This was initially less harmful, as microeconomics was seen only as one of many potentially useful methodologies, while Keynesian and institutional economics were more widely used to analyze the broader economy without relying on microeconomic derived methodologies. However, after formalizing the work of Alras, microeconomics began to expand its reach, deriving not just isolated behavior in detached markets, but general equilibrium for the whole economy. In the 1950s, Arrow and Debreu supposedly saw the invisible hand, proving the existence of general equilibrium. This required further assumptions of increasing cost with scale, no externalities, and all goods being roughly substitutable. Economic imperialism. After this implosion, excluding all other findings and methodologies from microeconomics, it then exploded outwards, taking over not only more and more of economics, but also using its methodology to explain things in other social sciences. It began by expanding to analyze not just markets, but economic history and its dazzling array of non-market institutions and politics. The contradiction of this explosion is that it begins by assuming that social factors, states, and institutions do not exist, and then uses this to analyze social factors, states, and institutions. The only justification for doing this is to use individual rational behavior as the prime causal determinant of everything. This is theoretically unsound, because institutions, historical and political factors, play a large role in determining individual behavior, which isn't really rationally optimizing anyway. Also, it doesn't give unique predictions as a methodology, because almost any outcome can be arrived at if one just reverse engineers the right individual preferences to derive them from. Compromise and expansion. More recently, there has emerged a number of dissenting schools of thought that critique neoclassical microeconomics, while still adopting much of its methodology uncritically. For example, information economics explains non-market institutions as a result of market failure, rather than having their own rich history and social role. These schools critique the complete neoliberal support of laissez-faire, but only in a relatively limited and deeply technocratic sense, with no real pervasive, systematic market failures, but rather a myriad of complex and unique failures of isolated markets, with policy solutions often focused on how to perfect markets in place of other, more interventionist solutions. This small compromise, allowing for the possibility of market failure, have resulted in the ability of microeconomic methodology to be spread with much greater credibility, explaining history, institutions, developing countries, welfare systems, and finance. However, this new reliance on factors outside of TA squared is done erratically and inconsistently, giving microeconomics only a veneer of general applicability. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please like, comment, and subscribe.